when we talk about Rust, I think one of the primary, you know, USPs of Rust that you know people talk about is the safety aspect of Rust. So what is safety? Safety is like you know, multi-headed beast. So the first aspect of safety is to do with types, the data types. Now you know there are programming languages that are statically typed, and there are dynamically typed languages. In dynamically typed languages, at compilation time, you don't know what value is going to be associated with a variable. So the compilers or the interpreters make some smart choices at runtime. They do some inference, and based on that, they do the calculations. But this gives rise to a lot of uncertainty or non-deterministic behavior when it comes to putting things in production. So Rust is a language which is statically typed, which means you know upfront what kind of value you're going to store in a variable. If you don't do that, the compiler will make sure that where you don't specify explicit types for a value or a variable, then the compiler will try to infer it. If it cannot infer, it will not let you proceed. So the Rust compiler I'm going to be talking about a lot during this session, because that's, you can have a love-hate relationship with your compiler. On one hand, it's the one that's going to frustrate you as you work in Rust. On the other hand, it's your best friend. So type safety is a key aspect of Rust. The second, and I would say, I would argue, or some would argue, the most important, most unique thing about Rust is its memory safety model. I'm going to spend a little bit more to talk about memory safety, and maybe I will, rather than talk through a slide, let me show you some code. So let's go to Rust Playground. It is an online IDE that's available, so you can quickly try out some code. Okay, so what I'm going to show you is to understand Rust's memory safety model. There is this unique concept called ownership in Rust. So I'm going to explain to you through some code samples how this works. So let's start with some examples. So first, I'm going to talk to you about some of the key rules of memory management. The first thing is that in Rust, by default, all variables are immutable. And when you move a value to another owner, or when you do an assignment operation, by default, stack allocated variables, the basic primitive types like the integers, the booleans and things, they are by default copy operations, okay? But the heap allocated variables, like the strings and the vectors, they are move operations, and I'm going to show you what that means here. So by default, let's look at what does a move operation mean in Rust. The second thing is I'm going to show you is when moving is not the only way to deal with values. Sometimes I don't want to move ownership from one value to another. What I want to do is I want to be able to borrow a value. So I'll show you how you can borrow values between variables, one in an immutable way. And you can also do it in a mutable way, mutable borrow. Then the fourth rule of memory safety or ownership I'll talk to you about is how does Rust do memory management, especially the deallocation of memory? So we'll talk about how the value is destroyed, deallocated. And last but not least, when you borrow a value from a variable, then Rust makes sure that the reference to a value does not outlive the value. So let's look at this. So these are if you distill Rust's ownership model, there's of course a lot more nuances, but if you understand these five key aspects, it'll give you an idea of what is unique about Rust's memory management model. Let's start with the move operation. So let's say I declare a variable. Okay, it's of type integer. Okay, and I assign a value to it. If I declare another variable, and I assign the value of x into y. So just to clarify the terminology, value and variable. Value is what is actually stored in memory, and a variable is just a name that refers to that location in memory. Okay. So in this case, what happens if I do a print? If I say value of x is and I'll do the same thing with y. All right, so I'm going to run this program. So at the bottom part of the screen, you can actually see the result. You can see that the value of y, x and y are printed. So what this means is that when you are doing an assignment operator, right, on a primitive data type, the basic data type like an integer, the value, when you do an assignment, the value of 5 is copied from x to y, which means at the end of the operation, both x and y have got the same value associated with it. Okay, so this is a very basic operation. Now, and this is the case in many programming languages. But what becomes interesting is when you look at, instead of a basic type, if you try the same thing with something like a Boolean, also the same, it will happen. You just copy the values. Yeah. But if, let's say we declare a type string. A string is a dynamically allocated variable because you don't know upfront what is the length of string. In the case of integer, if you say i32, you're talking of 32 bits or 4 bytes. The compiler knows it can allocate so much of memory. When you talk of a string, you don't know what is the length of the string that you're going to get when you're running the program. So in this case, what Rust's memory management system does is it allocates a set of memory in the heap area of the process. So let me initialize x with a value. Now let's try to assign this, right? We're assigning the value of x to y. So in this case, the compiler is smart enough. I don't have to explicitly declare the string type like this. I can do it if I want to, or I don't need to, because the compiler will be smart enough to infer that y is also of type string because I'm doing an assignment operator. So let's try to run this program. So you will see that the compiler will complain because it says, look at this, the compiler error messages in Rust are one of some of the most helpful I've seen. So look at this, it says borrow of moved value x. So what this means is that the value of x has been moved to y. Okay, unlike in the case of integers where the value of x was copied into y, here the value of x is moved into y. So it's able to print x, it cannot print y. It's able to print y, it cannot print x, because the value of x has already been moved, so it doesn't know what to print. So this is ownership in action in Rust, which means the heap allocated values are moved by default. Okay. Now what this means is that at any point of time, you just have one owner for a value. And the compiler tracks the ownership of a value through its life cycle. Okay. And that's a very, very powerful concept. So what happens at the end of it, what it does is, when the owner of the value, let's say in this case, y is the owner of the value. Here, x is the owner of the value. Hello. When you move it to y becomes the new owner. So this way, as through the program, the compiler checks where all the value gets assigned to. And that's an important aspect of Rust's ownership model. The next one I want to talk to you about is borrowing. So when moving values between variables is one thing, but there could be times when I don't want to be the owner of some piece of data. I just want to borrow it for some time and I want to give it back to you. So So let's look at that example. We'll comment this. So let's do the same thing again. Declare a type of string, initialize it. So string.from is a method available on the string data type, which lets you create a string type from a static set of text. Right. So now let's create a variable y, and this time y is going to borrow the value of x. So it's unlike the previous case where we moved the value. You see this ampersand. The ampersand represents a reference to a value. It's kind of like pointers in C++, but it's not the same. Here, what happens is I can try to print out the values of x and y. So let's see what happens. Okay, so here I'm able to print out the value. You see this? So just by borrowing a value, I no longer am constrained by the move semantics, because now it's no longer move, it's borrow semantics. So I have borrowed the value of x and the y. So both y has access to data, x also has access to the same piece of data, which is the hello value. So this is called an immutable borrow. It's called immutable borrow because I'm just borrowing the data. I have no intention of modifying this value. The value of x, I don't want to modify. I just want to use it, read it, and we do something with it. Okay. So that's an immutable borrow. Now, there will be situations when you write a program where you want to borrow a value but also modify it. Yeah. So let's look at that as the third case. And that's called the mutable borrowing situation. So just going to copy paste it faster. Right. Now this time I'm going to try and borrow, this time with a mute keyword. So this is the way you borrow mutably. The first thing is, when you declare x, you have to say it's a mutable value. So this is very important. By default, all variables are immutable. So when I just say, let me just show you that. If I just say that x, it's x, and if I try to modify the value of x, right, let me say I'm going to append something to the string. So there is a utility method here, and I just want to say hello there. So all I'm doing is I've created x, and then I'm just trying to append something to it. You see, it says you cannot borrow x is mutable, because by default, everything is immutable in Rust. Why this benefits is that you don't accidentally modify a value which you don't intend to. So the compiler expects you to be very explicit about this. And so if you have any intention of modifying the value, you must specify the mute keyword so that the compiler knows that you want to do some state changing operation with that value. So now if you run the program, it goes through. So you're able to assign it. So let's go back to our example. And here what we're going to do is assign borrow the value of x mutably. So create a variable called y, and then mutable value of x. And then now let me try to modify y. Now that y has got a copy of the data, not a copy of the data, it has a reference to the data that is owned by x, but y should be able to modify that value. So let's do that here. And we'll print out the values of x and y. See what happens here. Okay. Now you'll find an error which looks weird. It says you cannot borrow x as immutable because it's also borrowed as mutable. So what this means is that when you're actually trying to print something, implicitly, the value of x is borrowed immutably, right? Now, Rust's ownership rules state that when you are borrowing X mutably, already you've done this. You see the statement in line number 18. You're already borrowing the value of X mutably. When you have already a mutable reference outstanding, you cannot have any more references to the same value, whether it's mutable or immutable. And that's why you're seeing this. So let me remove the statement and try to print it. Okay, so here it is. So this is an important ownership rule, which says that once you borrow a value mutably, the same value cannot be borrowed immutably or mutably, which means at any point of time, there's only one reference to a value. Now, these are very powerful primitives to make sure that, you know, memory is handled in a very safe manner. Because the moment you have a reference and you pass it around to multiple, variables, and each one has got the opportunity to modify it in unpredictable ways. So by design, Rust prevents these kinds of situations. Right? So that's where all these ownership rules come in. So that's the mutable borrow. Now let's look at, we've seen how to move a value, how to borrow mutably and immutably. Now, what is unique about Rust's ownership model is not just these move and borrow semantics, but the point is that as a developer, I don't have to remember to deallocate memory when I no longer need it. Now, this is one of the biggest challenges when you use low-level languages like C or C++, because unless you are a very diligent and experienced programmer, forgetting to release memory at the right time can either result in situations where you have things like null pointer dereferencing. So those kinds of things will arise, or you have dangling pointers. So these things can be completely avoided, or they are completely avoided in Rust, because Rust doesn't even let you do that. What Rust does is that it does the automatic deallocation of memory for you when the owner goes out of scope. So I'll show you this with an example before we talk more about it. So we'll take the same example again. Let's declare X. I'm just leaving these in there so that you can refer back to it if you want to rewatch the stream. So let's do this. So I'm going to create another lexical scope within the scope. So if you see this pair of enclosing braces, within the main program, I'm actually creating this a statement within this block. And then let me try to access the value of X outside of this block. You see, it says it cannot find value of X in the scope. Right? You will say, of course it's in scope because it's in part of the main program. Right? This is the main program and I have it in scope. But the way Rust evaluates scope is that this has been declared within this inner block, and you're trying to access the value of X outside this inner block. So what is happening here is that within the block, Rust is allocating memory, and it's assigning the pointer to the memory, to the variable X. But the moment it sees this closing brace, it treats it as the end of scope of the owner of the value, which is X. And X no longer exists once you come out of the scope. And so at this point of time, what Rust does is it deallocates the memory associated with hello. So that memory is free to be reallocated to some other, someone else requesting for memory. That's known as the drop trait in Rust. So by default, Rust implements the drop traits for most of the standard types. And if you have your own custom type, you can specify what you want as part of the drop operation. But essentially, the power of this is Rust enables you to do low-level memory management without using a garbage collector. So if you look at most of the so-called safe, this dichotomy between high-level and low-level languages is also about safety versus performance as a trade-off. if you look at high level languages like, you know, Java, the Pythons, the Rubies, JavaScript, all these are treated as high level, not because they are, this thing, but because, you know, they make it easy for you to write safe programs. You can write safe programs from the point of view of memory safety, because a lot of this plumbing is taken care of by the, by your runtimes there, either the compilers or the interpreters or the JVMs. They take care of the, you know, automatic memory management for you. Rust allows you to do automatic memory management without a garbage collector. At the same time, you have low-level control over how you allocate memory. So I think that is where the power of Rust comes from. So that's the deallocation, how it releases memory. And the last aspect I want to talk to you about when it comes to memory safety is that, remember we spoke about how you can borrow a value. Now, let's again do that. Let's create a variable. And let's borrow a value. This time we'll do it. We'll do an immutable borrow. We don't need mute. So again, let's put this within within a block to simulate scope. So within the we are declaring a variable y outside the block. Okay. Now within the block, we're declaring a value of x, and within the block, we are allocating or we are, you know, borrowing the value of x here. All right. It's pretty simple. I've just created a variable. I'm borrowing the value of x and assigning it to y. Okay. Now here, if I try to print out the value, this should work. The value of y should work. Now let me delete this one. Okay, so you see that within the block, you can actually access the value of y. And you can print it out. But let's see what happens if I just move this print statement outside of this block. It doesn't compile because it tells you x does not live long enough. What this means is that, you know, because x has been declared within the scope, once x goes out of scope, that memory has been deallocated. But what is happening is, you see this, the value of y is still, y's lifetime is still not completed, which means y is still alive and kicking. So when you here, this is a case of a dangling pointer. Y has got a reference to x, and that where the, you know, the value of x has been deallocated. It's a classic case of dangling pointer. And Rust tells you upfront that, you know, you're trying to do this, it will not allow you to go forward. So what Rust is doing is it's trying to make sure that the reference to a value does not outlive the value itself, right? The reference to a value can, the lifetime of a reference to a value can be less than or equal to the lifetime of the value. And that's what Rust ensures. And all this is done through static checks at compilation time. You're not going to get any weird runtime errors because, you know, because you forgot to do the right sequencing of these statements. Okay, so what we've seen are five important rules. One, we've seen that, you know, five or six important rules. One is by default, everything is a move operation in Rust for heap allocated variables. Then we saw how you can borrow a value immutably. You can borrow a value mutably. We've seen how Rust deallocates memory when the owner of the value goes out of scope. And we've also seen how Rust tracks the references with respect to the values and makes sure that the reference to a value does not outlive the value. It could be a lot if you're coming in from another programming language. But, you know, there's no point just telling you that memory is safe in Rust, you know, unless you get a glimpse of, you know, what that means. And these are the foundational concepts of Rust. As you can see, as we go through even simple programs, the compiler will hit you very hard. It'll tell you you can't go forward. And, you know, you have to accommodate the compiler. But at the end of the day, one thing that I have personally realized is once you have a program that has gone through all the compiler checks, you know, a lot of downstream problems you avoid. So that's a good thing. So you can be secure that you're not going to get unpredictable errors at runtime. So that's memory safety in a nutshell for you.